Toronto certainly had a creative boom. Eugene Levy and a guy named John Yaffe and I shared a house, 1063 Avenue Road in Toronto. And this house had more parties and great parties. And, you know, Paul Schaefer, who was also in Godspell, would get up and play the piano and people would sing. And it was really kind of, you know, fantastic when you think of it. At the time, I was doing Godspell at night, and during the day, I was hosting my own rock show called Right On. And it was CBC Live at 5 p.m., and I'd sing the top songs of the week. You know, and I'd have a guest, please welcome Miss Althea DeGregorio, and she'd come on and she'd sing, you know, I don't know, a Carly Simon song. And I'd do, you know, I'd open with an Al Green song, but I had no funk at all. Long hair, but, you know, I shot the sheriff, but I did not shoot the deputy, ding, dong, ding. I mean, it was just pathetic. That went off quickly. And so we were always doing, television shows during, or series or episodics during the day. And then we'd do these shows at night, whether it was Second City or Godspell first, and then Andrea and I did a cabaret show. What's a nice country like you doing in a state like this? You know, satirizing the Watergate scandal. I'm Holliman, I'm Ehrlichman, I'm Klein, the three sauerkrauts from the Rhine. You know, that was a big hit show. And that was the world of Toronto back then, with all these John Candy and Danny Aykroyd, as I said, and Valerie Bromfield, all these great, talented people, and Gilda and Andrea and everyone. And everyone kind of dated each other and partied with each other and worked with each other. It was quite very creative, very fun. And I remember the first person to be taken to the States to do something was Paul Schaefer, who was going to play the Magic Show. And I remember Gilda and I being on a phone, and we both said to him, Paul, what are American actors like? And Paul said, well, I don't know. Maybe it's just me. Maybe because you're my friends. I think you guys are just as good. But we found it all very intimidating, the idea of the United States and New York actors and what that might be like. Spring of 1973, this would now be almost at the end of our year run of Godspell, Second City came to town. But I didn't audition for it. Everyone else was so excited about it. And I, because I was kind of like, funny guy at parties, and I just kind of felt I wanted to do plays, and I wanted to do musicals, and I wanted to do other things. And they were so enthusiastic about the potential of being in Second City. And I kept thinking, well, you probably have to be that enthusiastic. You have to want it that bad to do well in it. And I thought, you know, when I am that enthusiastic about the potential of being in it, that's probably when I should do it. And also, yeah, obviously, I was probably scared of the idea of improvising and all this stuff. So I didn't join Second. So that's, they all joined Second City, and I didn't join Second City at that time. I joined, I think, 4 years later. I'd been in Los Angeles, and I'd seen an improvisational group called War Babies. And I thought they were just fantastic. And I thought, as I watched it, that's what I'd like to do. So I phoned up Andrew Alexander, who I knew. Second City was now, stage was a success in Toronto. And I said, boy, and I had been asked in the past to join Second City and declined. And so I said, boy, if there's ever an opening, I'm now interested in doing it. So in kind of Godfather-like way, he fired a guy and then put me in the cast. I did Second City for 2 years, stage. And then I left Second City. I went down to Los Angeles. I did a TV series that James Brooks wrote called The Associates. And that was on and off. And then I did next year I did a TV series for ABC called I'm a Big Girl Now, where I played Neil Stryker, the office boy, with Thomas Harris. It was Danny Thomas, Diana Canova, and Sherry North. I was Sherry's assistant. This was a show that we did 19 episodes, and it wasn't, you know, killing in the ratings. So they felt they had to fix, you know, play with the show as they do. And so we were a think tank in Washington. But by the 14th show, they just switched it. We were now a newspaper. No explanation. No one explained. We were just a newspaper. So I did that, and then that was one season, and that was canceled. And now we're into 1982, and you know, now I'm kind of looking around what to figure next, and these people, you know, Dave Rick and Catherine were going to leave the show, so that gave me this great opportunity, kind of, you know, rescued. I did three 90-minute shows with the original cast, with Dave and Rick and Catherine all involved. And there hadn't been a read-through for a while. I think this is the first read-through for a while, and I had written a piece with my brother Michael called Jerry Lewis Live at the Champs-Élysées. And we wrote two pieces. And the other one was, I played Ron Galella, the photographer.
I'm a nobody, a paparazzo, but I'm chasing the most desirable woman in the world, Jackie O. If you're like me, you want every picture to turn on half decent. That's why I use a Planota MX. It's a super camera. Planota MX is totally waterproof. You don't have to screw around with f-stops or light meters. Everything's automatic.
You? I thought you were in jail.
I remember Andrea just being, she said, how could you have gotten two pieces into your first read-through? You know, because I was green and excited to be in this brilliant show. And then I remember after the read-through, Mike Short kept a bottle of whiskey in the bottom. He had two bottom drawers. One drawer had antacid, Pepto, and all the things for his, because it was a stressful show to work on, a lot of work. And then below that was a bottle of whiskey, which, of course, would negate the Pepto. And so first, Mike and I went and took a swig of whiskey, and then there was a knock on the door, and there was Joe Flaherty. Mike, can I have a little shot of that whiskey, too? That was my first read-through.
The SCTV Television Network is now on the air.
Camera 2, wind down a little bit, please. Coming up on camera 1, pan right.
Starring John Candy. Joe Flaherty. Levy, Andrea Martin, and Martin Short. Television as you've never seen it before. This is the SCTV Television Network.
At that time, this would be probably April of 1982. And the show, SCTV, was huge. I mean, not just huge in the sense of, I mean, I don't know what the ratings were, but from a critical standpoint, and if you were in comedy and show business, the perception of it couldn't have been higher. So it was thrilling to be in it, but it was also a little daunting because I knew everyone in the cast. I Andrea Martin, you know, is my sister-in-law. My brother Michael was working on the show. I knew the cast from all the way back to, you know, Dave Thomas and Eugene and I went to university together. I'd known Catherine Harris since she was 17. I'd known Joe Flaherty since I was 22. And John Candy, of course, same time. So, I mean, I knew these people, so that should have made it kind of relaxing, and it was, but it was also their accomplishment so far made it daunting. So I remember that strange ambiguity of feeling nervous while at the same time saying, what am I nervous about? These are my old friends.
Oh, I can't believe it's a white Christmas. I mean, it couldn't be much more perfect, I must say. Thank you, Bing. Oh, as if he had anything to do with it. But you know, I bet in a way he did. Oh, this is insane. I gotta get to sleep. It's like torture. What if I woke up in the morning and I found out my stocking was full? I think I would be found dead from excitement, you know? Okay, that's it. I gotta go downstairs and see if anything's happened yet.
Get to bed!
They're right. I should be in bed, but I'm just too excited.
A lot of things would start on Second City stage and then become staples of SCTV. Ed Grimley started on Second City stage. There was a show that Second City stage was doing called The Wizard of Ossington. Ossington is a street in Toronto. And I replaced John Candy in the show. John left the stage show, and so I took his roles. And in one scene, it was a scene called Sexist. And the premise was that a guy and a girl are applying for the same job, and the woman is clearly qualified, and the man is completely not qualified. And the employer keeps hearing the, and saying, gee, I just can't decide. You're both so good. And it was clearly because he was favoring the man. So I did it as this character I called Ed Grimley. But he didn't really sound like my brother-in-law kind of talks like that. So Ed was kind of like this a little bit. And also I'd known a guy in high school who always went up like that. He'd always say, you know, he wanted to be a photographer. I took a lot of slides this weekend, but I didn't develop them because I had taken them, so I felt it would be redundant to also develop them. I was like 16 thinking, well, I can't forget this. So between my brother-in-law, Ralph, and this guy who talked like that, I would do this scene in Sexist as this guy at Grimley who would talk like this and not be very qualified for the job. And then I used to grease my hair a little bit. And Peter Aykroyd was playing the employer, Danny's brother. And one night he said, you know, that hair is standing taller. Every night you do it now, it's getting bigger. So as a joke to make him laugh, I put it completely up in a point. And the audience laughed. And I thought, well, isn't that the point of the scene, to make them laugh? So that's how Ed Grimley's hair got established. And one time, Catherine O'Hara was the girl, and she was downstage from me, and I looked at her, and I kind of went like this. And the audience laughed, so I thought, well, why wouldn't I? So I just held it and then started doing that a lot. And that's kind of, and then because you were doing it every night, that scene, in the run of a show, that's how the characters would get kind of evolved.
The main thing about the snake is not to act scared. You shouldn't act scared, you know. So today we're going to look at a live cobra. And maybe some of the pieces of the puzzle we call snake will just, they'll be okay. Let's bring them out and take a look. You might be a little shy of the lights. The main secret here is to use your own intellect so you won't fall into the snake's hypnotic stare. Yes, master.
And the first piece I did as Ed Grimley on SCTV was a scene where he's talking about snakes. It was a Sunrise semester. And I remember one point Dave Thomas walked through the studio.
I said, Dave, come here. Look at this take. What am I doing here? What should I do?
And he saw the take. He said, I have no idea what you're doing. But just keep doing it. It's funny. But I can't help you with this. It's insane.
You know, in my business, or in our business, when a song lingers, man, it becomes what we like to call a standard. This next standard, we haven't really changed that much. Let's just say we put a new dress in the old gal. Dig.
Animal crackers in my shoe. Animal crackers move the loop. Gosh, oh gee, but I have fun eating animal crackers. One. Ah!
God, wait a minute. That was close. Look at the director down there. Would you not worry? It will take more than a tree to kill a Jackie Rogers, I'll tell you.
Jackie Rogers Jr. was a name that I actually, when I was about 9, I thought, about being in show business. I had an applause record. I led a private life, a very unusual life. You know, people would be, when I was 15, I would have the Martin Short Show in my attic. And I would, I had an applause record from Sinatra at the Sands that I put in a loop. I had a gooseneck lamp that I arch up, and that would be my key light. Still very important. And to this day, and I had a fictitious variety show, Tuesdays 8:30, every other week. Not every week, because if it was every week, I wouldn't have any time for my imaginary film career.
Oh.
So I was so busy. And meanwhile, you know, outside, kids my age are protesting Vietnam. Oh, world's watching, and I'm up in my attic going, weather-wise, such a cuckoo day, you know. And I type things up for TV Guide. And
wow.
Yeah. So I one of the characters, I thought that one of my stage names would be Jackie Rogers. So that's where I got the name from.
She loves me, and my amazement, I love her. She needs me, but she doesn't show it. Why should she when she does not know it? Yesterday she loves me, ha, now today she hates me, but and tomorrow, oh, she loves me, she loves me.
Ladies and gentlemen, my mother, Mrs. Jackie Rogers Sr.
Jackie was a white-faced albino, and that was a piece that was written probably in the fall of 82 by Dick Blasucci and Paul Flaherty, Mike Short, and I. And we all wrote that together, and we wrote a piece called Jackie Rogers, Old Mother Nature, She Loves Me. And the premise was that I thought that even then that because Bill Murray had the club singer, that club singers were satirizing club singers was kind of had been done. But I thought, well, if we kill the character off in this one piece, then that's fine.
Pardon me, miss, but I never been kissed by a real live squirrel.
And at the end of the piece, we needed his son to pop on and say, I miss my dad, I hope you won't, Thursdays at 9, because we're now going to show the special. And I had seen a photograph of Mickey Rooney Jr., and he looked very pale in it. So we made him an albino. And then about a month later, Eugene Levy said, I want to do, let's do a scene with Bobby Bittman and Jackie Rogers. And I said, well, Jackie Rogers, it will have to be the albino son. Eugene said, I don't want to work with the albino son. I want to work with Jackie Rogers. I said, well, Jackie Rogers is dead. I don't want to work with the son. But we ended up working with the son, and that was the second Jackie piece.
And if that ain't a song cue, then I don't know what. Are you ready, Jackie?
You better believe it, Augie. Don't cry for me, Argentina. We're supposed to have been immortal. That's all I wanted. Not much to ask for. I kept my promise.
Do not keep your distance.
I kept my promise.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you.
Yeah, people hated that character. And yet I kept doing him.
Hey, you Charmaise, walk along. Louis, that's a cue. You Charmaise, walk along. When I do the cry, you do the cue. Cry, cue. You like your job? Do it.
genius! Bravo, bravo! A genius!
That was an exciting piece to do, Jerry Lewis, because it was my first, Mike and I wrote it, short, and it was my, you know, the other things that I'd done on the show were, here's a part, try this part, or, you know, do this line, or play this guy, or, but this was the first piece that I co-authored and felt a real ownership, and that's when SCTV worked at its best for the cast and writers, which was when you really felt like you were creating something on your own from your own mind. And I remember Eugene coming up to me after the read-through, where it was passed in the read-through, and you know, now going to happen, and he said, you know, do you want to do this? In other words, this is going to be shown, and it's, you know, I always felt like whenever I would do any of these sketches or any of these people, that they're always kind of like Hirschfelds. You know, you're showing, it's important to show why, for example, I thought Jerry Lewis was brilliantly funny, but you're also showing some warts. You're showing some temperament, and but you're putting a name to it. You're not putting a fake name to it. Like Bill Jackson, you're calling him Jerry Lewis, and it's going to go out there, and there might be a ramification.
Get him another drink.
Well, I should get the drinks for it, because without drinks, when you're thirsty, then you still are dry.
You fool!
Oh, I didn't mean to!
Oh, I'm sorry!
What are you doing?
Years later, I think it was something like 9 years later, I met Jerry Lewis and interviewed him. And I remember being nervous about it, being nervous that he might have seen it, might not have liked it, because I did Jerry Lewis a few times. And at one point during that, Jerry said, didn't you do me? And my heart, well, yeah, I did. Yeah. And he said, you did me on the telethon. And I said, no, I didn't do you on the telethon. I did you live at the Champs-Élysées, as if it was a concert film by Martin Scorsese. And he went, oh, and that made him laugh. Mm-hmm. And then I said, I also did you, you know, scenes as if you and Bergman in Scenes from an Idiot's Marriage. And he went, you made a lot of money off me.
This season, the CBC, recognized the world over as the leader in sports coverage, brings you for the 10th consecutive year.
One. Rotate.
Monday Night Curling with your announcers, Dandy Dick Bedloe, Gord McKee, and Gord McClellan. You will be there for all the exciting play-by-play action and color commentary, as well as the weekly curling tip with Howie McMeeker. Winner of 25 Nellie Awards for its outstanding coverage, Monday Night Curling is back as only the CBC can cover it.
Sweep, 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 sweep.
You say you're a Canadian actor?
Yes.
I'm going to have to pass.
Sandra Wicks.
I recognize that voice. Is it Raymond Massey?
No. Panel, I'm afraid we can't spend any more time on this. Would you remove your blindfolds, please? And we'll continue the questioning with Austin McGrath.
That voice is so familiar. I have no idea.
Well, the big concern about the CBC show was, how do you parody Canadian television and make it at all interesting to Americans who don't know what you're parodying? In other words, how do you parody something if no one is familiar with the thing that you're parodying? But what I found, and have since found endlessly, is that what SCTV was doing was creating characters. So, for example, in Canada, Brock Linehan was a satire of a very successful interviewer named Brian Linehan. In the United States, he was and maybe they didn't know Brian Linehan as well, but they knew him just as a generic character called Brock Linehan. And because these characters, everyone's instinct from Second City Training was to give it kind of a three-dimension, even if it was an abstract, broad character, it still was grounded in some kind of truth that people just bought it as generic characters, even if it was based on someone. So for the CBC show, if you're Canadian, you knew that these scenes were satirizing some shows that really existed. For the Americans, they just thought it was funny.
Instead of going into a third week with this particular group of contestants, I'm going to pick a number from 1 to 10. And the contestant that comes closest to that number, I will personally declare the winner. A number from 1 to 10 will start with Darren Peel.
12.
A number from 1 to 10, Blanche Ray.
That's what I was going to say, 12.
I'm looking for a number from 1 to 10, Arthur Andrew Liggett.
Oh, this is tough. Any number, Alex?
Just pick a number!
12.
Lawrence Orbach.
Now I've lost track, Alex. Could you repeat the numbers that have already been taken?
And we're out of time.
I always remember when we did the Halfwits, and one of the ideas was that we would, it was a quiz show, Halfwits, and we would, none of us wore makeup, because we were finding that we were spending so much time in the makeup room that it was delaying production schedule. So everyone said, okay, we're just going to kind of look like ourselves, right? Yes, absolutely. And one day I walked in, I saw a Bev Sheckman carving. It looked like a mini Buddha she was working on. I said, what is that thing you're working on? Joe Flaherty's nose for Halfwits. I said, okay, that's it. I want a bald pate and pockmarks.
Rusty, I want you to show me what you did to your teacher.
All righty, whoa-ho-ho!
Oh, That Rusty was a piece written by Bob Dolman, my brother-in-law, and Michael Short, my brother. And it was a sat. I'd seen Gary Coleman in Different Strokes. And he was now, 31, and he was still playing an 8-year-old. And so the premise was that Rusty Van Reddick had been a child star, but had now been doing the show for now 33 years, and they were hiring giants to make him look small and making the set bigger, and his voice was now like that, and he'd been arrested for shoplifting and had about 5 ex-wives, but he was still playing an innocent. And in the there's a scene that we shot where Rusty goes in and berates the writers and fires one of the writers, and the writer that I fire is my brother Michael. Rusty, where were they? Who the hell is he? Get him out. You're gone.
We thought, Rusty, that the little girl...
The little girl? Who are you? Who is he?
He's a new writer, Rusty.
Yeah, he's fired. Oh.
The premise was that William B. Williams, John Candy, had left the Sammy Maudlin Show to do his own show. And it was such a disaster that even his guests berated him and said, you're no Sammy Maudlin, you've made a mistake by leaving. And Irving Cohen, I think it was Dick Bosucci, Paul Flaherty, Mike Short, and Marty Short, creating an old songwriter that would come on. And, he'd written... It was like based on Steve Allen, who always had a tape recorder and was writing, 25 songs a week. So Irving had written, 28,000 songs, 2,000 since lunch. And, he'd say, in fact, I feel another song coming on, either that or the Metamucil's kicking in. Give me a C, a bouncy C, by Sammy. And he'd bring it to another song.
Irving Cohen.
I say something to you, to this man, and I hope I don't embarrass you, William B., but it's something that I have to say.
Okay.
You never should have left the Sammy Maudlin Show. It was a mistake that you live to regret. Because you don't fool with a combination like that.
There was a big challenge to SCTV when they lost Dave and Rick and Catherine. I mean, I think that many people question whether this is going to limp along or whether it was going to certainly, how could it be as good as it was? And, but I remember there was a great looseness that last year. And a lot of great pieces got written. There was an ease to it. I don't think, I think we actually did better than we thought we were going to do. Mm-hmm.